Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for coming this morning. I am really personally excited for you to meet the speaker today, if you've not yet had a chance to hear our wonderful speaker. But I'm really excited that we as Mesa College are celebrating this International Women's Day by having our sixth annual Gracia and Molina de Pic Feminist Lecture Series event. It's important that as a college, we represent all of the students who come here and the community in which we are so wonderfully embedded. And such a large part of our community really has its foothold at Mesa College many generations back. So what we try to do is create an environment here so that you can then tell the folks that come after you to Mesa College, because of course we want all of your families and all of your kids and cousins and brothers and anybody else who wants to come to Mesa to come to school here. One of the things that we have done at Mesa is decided that we are going to call ourselves the leading college of equity and excellence.
Yes.
And what that means to us is providing an environment so that everyone thrives and can become their greatest potential. And so one of the things that we'll do today is give a speaker to you that'll talk a little bit about how she does that and the community that we create here at Mesa. On this International Women's Day, I think it's important to point out that, from my own perspective, I think the word feminism has really taken a beating of late. And while I'm not wearing red shirt, I have red shoes on.
Yes.
Because I look better in blue. So just wanted to say that. The reason that I think that we need to be careful about how we characterize the word feminism is because it, as many words do, it means many things to many different people. All of us have multiple identities, whether it's gender, whether it's our ethnicity, whether it's our experience, whatever those might be. We are all amalgams of a number of different experiences. But to me, what feminism means is that we support one another as women, and that all of us in this community support what it means to be a woman and what a fully empowered female experience looks like in the world. And that's things like equal pay for equal work, right? That's things like having access to higher education.
Yes.
That's things like making sure that in a classroom, we have faculty who embrace every student who's in your class with you and treat you with the respect that you have absolutely brought to this college. So I want you to know that I'm really excited to have you here today. I'm excited for you to hear our speaker, and I'm really happy that you attend or at least have come to visit Mesa College today, because we're excited to have you here. So welcome, and I just realized I didn't introduce myself. That worked out well. I'm President Luster. Just wanted to throw that out there to you. I'm the president of San Diego Mesa College. People look at me like they know me, and it's because when you sit in, my face comes up a lot on those screens on campus. So, you never quite know where I'll pop up. But thank you for being here today, and on behalf of Mesa, welcome to Mesa. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, President Luster. Hi, everybody. I'm Victoria Chavez. I'm a professor in the I'm a professor in the Department of Chicana Studies, and I'm just going to take a couple minutes to talk a little bit first about feminism and specifically Chicana feminism before I introduce our speaker today. So first of all, welcome to the sixth annual Gracia Molina de Pic Feminist Lecture Series. We are very pleased to have her son Daniel with us here today. Thank you for being here with us. And I'm going to start the way I usually start, because I really want to talk about this idea of feminism. Let's see. How many feminists in the room? Let's see the hands. Okay, that's good. There's so much more of you. You're hiding. You don't realize it. I know that word is so scary for so many of us when we hear that word, or it's confusing. So let's see really how many feminists. How many of you believe that men and women should be paid equally, equal work, equal pay? How many of you believe in that? Right on. How many of you believe that all people, regardless of gender, should receive equal treatment under the law? How many of you believe that? How many believe that a person of any gender can be a good parent and should share in the responsibility of raising a child? How many of you believe that opportunities should not be limited by the sex that you identify as? And how many of you believe that your body is your own and you should not be limited in what you can do with it? How many of you believe that? Wow, you're all feminist. Amazing. That's wonderful. Fantastic. That word often gets a little muddled, but these are some of the core basic ideas that we have in mainstream feminism. However, Chicana feminism is a little different, has a little different perspective. It recognizes that it is not possible to isolate our gender from our race, our culture, our sexuality, our age, our religion, or our class status. All of these factors intersect and feed off of one another to make us who we are. I am a Chicana feminist because I cannot separate my race from my culture, from my gender. This is because my race and my culture have greatly impacted the woman I have become. I also refuse to rate those factors in terms of importance, because one does not exist without the other. Being a woman, being a feminist, has impacted me just as much as being a feminist, as being a Chicana. This mestiza consciousness is about allowing contradictions, this radical open space of the borderlands allows us to be any form of Chicana we take on, monolingual, bilingual, indigenous, Mexican, American. It rejects those sections, the sectioning of class, race, and gender as separate identities. We see these different parts of ourselves as intertwined, all connected to one another. It is about these multiple identities and accepting these identities for ourselves. It's about being queer, multicultural, multiracial, multilingual. It's about challenging what is the status quo and embracing that ambiguity. If you believe in these things too, then you too are a Chicana feminist. Today, it is our great pleasure to have Dr. Maria Nieto Senour, who is the president of the San Diego Community College District Board of Trustees, with us here today. She is the first Latina elected in a citywide school or college board office in the city of San Diego. The first. In that position and in the community work she has done, Maria has been an advocate for children and for increasing staff and student diversity in education, because that is what truly makes for a rich learning environment. Dr. Senour served as a member of the San Diego Convention Center Board of Directors, and she is currently a professor in the Department of Counseling and School Psychology at San Diego State. Dr. Nieto Senour was also named Professor of the Year by San Diego State in 1993. On top of all of that, she does extensive volunteer work. She's a past board member of LEAD San Diego, has served as a consultant on race relations to the San Diego Housing Commission. She's been a trainer to numerous departments of probation across the state of California on how to work with Latino offenders. She's been a consultant to various educational and community organizations on women, cross-cultural, and Latino issues. She has done a lot and will continue to do more. She is here today to speak to us. Let us give her a warm welcome.
Good morning, and thank you so much for that kind introduction. Today, as you have heard several times, is a day without a woman. We're all supposed to not be here. What would this room look like if we weren't here? What would this district look like if all the women were not here? We wouldn't have a chancellor. We wouldn't have some of our presidents. We wouldn't have our vice chancellors. There, we wouldn't have our faculty, our students, our staff. There's so many roles in this district that women fill. And each and every one of us has an important job to do in it. My role being on the board is to oversee how things get done. My role is to set policy, to modernize policy, because one of the things that happens is that with time things change and there's new rules and we have to adjust what we do in terms of our policies and procedures and how we operate as a district. The board hires the chancellor, and the chancellor is the one who runs everything. And you all know, I hope, who she is. Dr. Constance Carroll is our chancellor, and she's a brilliant person, one of the most, if not the most, brilliant people I've ever met in my life, and extremely competent at everything that she does. She's not perfect. Neither am I. Neither are you. We're all crazy, for one thing. I'm a counselor educator. I taught at San Diego State University since 1977 is when I started teaching there. And I have now retired, so I'm a professor emeritus now, but I do go back and meet with groups and talk with folks and continue to really believe in the process of training multicultural counselors. A couple of my former students are here, actually, and parents of one of my former students are here, and so we've trained a lot of diverse counselors, and I'll talk with you a little bit more about that. But before I do that, the title is Centering Community, Culture, and Social Justice in Education. That's a title of what I'm addressing today. So let me start with a little bit of demographics. You may be familiar with some of this, or with a lot of this, or with none of this. I don't know. As I think you know now, there is no single racial or ethnic group in California that represents a majority. We're what they often call a majority-minority state. In this state, the largest group are Latinos, and Spanish is the language that's most often spoken outside of English. About 26% of public school students in 2011-12 identified as white, non-Hispanic. 52% of the students identified as Latinos. We also had about 11% Asians, 7% African Americans, 0.7% Native Americans, 0.6% Pacific Islanders, and we have about 2% of our students are mixed race, and Latinos have made up the state's public school majority since 2010. So there's a lot of us, and you can see that by looking around this room, right? There's a lot of us. However, Asians remain the fastest growing racial group in the United States. So Asians are growing quickly. China has replaced Mexico as the racial group that sends the most folks to the U.S. now, according to the new information from the Census Bureau. In 2013, it replaced Mexico as the top sending country for immigrants. And the second fastest racial group are those who claim two or more races. So we're doing what some people have been afraid of, which is mingling the races. And I think that's been the fear of some folks who would like to stop this, because they're afraid they're not going to recognize their grandchildren. And in some cases, that's the case. You should see my partner's grandchildren. My partner's sitting at the corner over there. Wave, Ernie. Wave.
The good-looking one
up front. He's got these two little white-skinned, blue-eyed, curly-haired, blonde-haired grandchildren that he takes to the park, and I'm sure people think he's kidnapping them all the time. Those are his grandchildren, because things like that happen. My grandchildren are Filipino and Mexican. So one of the things that we know is that the demographics are changing, and no matter what bans we impose, no matter what changes we put in our immigration policies or in our deportation policies or whatever we do, this country will continue to become more and more and more and more and more diverse.
Yes.
No matter what.
Yes.
No matter what else happens. no matter what else happens, the white population is the slowest growth population we have. They're, by comparison to Asians and Latinos, it's an aging group. And so what does that have to do with what we do at the colleges and universities? Well, I think that means that we have to take into account the reality of culture. And one of the things that I've learned in my life by the work that I've done is that culture profoundly affects who we are and how we see the world in ways that most of us don't even recognize most of the time. We just sort of go along with whatever it is. We have ingrained belief systems about what's right and wrong, or how you treat people, or how people ought to behave, things like that, that come from our cultural heritages. They really impact us. The man who started the program that I've taught in for many years was a gentleman by the name of Dave Malcolm. He was a white gentleman from the East Coast, went to college at Harvard, and just had all kinds of advantages in life. And one of the things that he was really aware of was that there were a lot of people who lived life in very different ways than him. And he began to realize that that deeply impacted everything everyone does. And so the program that he started takes culture into consideration at a very deep level. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But think about the ways that our culture tells us about how men and women should be. What does the dominant culture of the United States say about how men are supposed to be? Anybody want to throw out a comment about that? How are men supposed to be? Strong, tough, stoic, do not cry, breadwinners. What else? Power brokers,
assertive.
Yeah, you've been shaped by society, and it's often invisible. As Dave Malcolm used to say, he doesn't know who it was that discovered water, but he knows it wasn't a fish. Because we tend to be immersed in what we're immersed in, and we don't see what we swim in because it's invisible to us. And that's how, and so the majority culture is a culture. The dominant culture of the United States that's shaped by Anglo-Saxon norms, it is a culture. People say, I don't have a culture. That's not true. If you go to other countries, you'll soon see that some of your beliefs and values are different from other people's. So it shapes how men are supposed to be. How are women supposed to be? Yes. What's that? Mothers. Absolutely. What's that? They're supposed to stay home and take care of the kids. They're supposed to be more dependent, nurturing, emotional, housekeeping,
asexual.
Yeah, women are not supposed to be very sexy, except when they're supposed to be. And then they're supposed to be sluts. And then they're supposed to be virgins. And how do you do that? Especially in my culture, my crazy culture, wants women to be both of those things. And so we walk around with real tight clothes and real high heels. I've seen women, Mexican women, climbing mountains in heels that I wouldn't walk down this place in. But, you know, you have to look sexy. Because you got to catch a guy, right? That's a lot of the beliefs about what men and women are. But there's a lot of other things besides that that are important. Men are not ever supposed to express fear, right? Men are courageous and fearless. And men are never supposed to be vulnerable, to be hurt, to be sad, to cry, as someone said. That's inappropriate for men. Men are allowed to be angry. So men, I have found, often turn their hurt and their fear into anger. And they act out in an angry way instead of expressing what they're really feeling. And often they don't know what they feel. Now, that's not true of all men. There's a lot of men that do not fit that stereotype. Ernie's a man that does not fit that stereotype. When we're watching TV, he's as likely to cry as I am when something is going on that's sad on television. So everybody doesn't fit the stereotypes, but we know what they are, right? Even if you don't fit it, you know what they are. And all women are not submissive and passive and you know, deferring to men and doing all the housework and picking up his underwear and socks and whatever for everybody else. All women don't necessarily want to do that or be that way. And all men don't necessarily want their wives or their partners to be that way. And when you have, you know, families that are made of two folks from the same gender, again, they divide tasks, and it's not because somebody's feminine or masculine or whatever. So those concepts are socially created to a large extent. There is some biological basis for some of it, but mostly, more than a little, it's shaped by society. Our cultures also tell us things like, who is important in a family? Are the oldest people? Do we honor our elders, like in a lot of the Asian communities? Or do we all want to be young, like here in this country? It's a real compliment to be told that you look young. And I often talk about being an old woman, and people say, oh, no, don't say that about yourself. You're not old. It's why we're using a bad word against myself. Hey, I've been around this planet for 73 and a half years. That's old. I don't expect, I'm not middle-aged. I'm not going to live to be 146. That's not going to happen. So I know that I'm an old woman, and I think that's fine. I don't want to die, but that's not the same thing. You probably don't want to die either, at least not right away, hopefully. But eventually, that's going to happen. Culture also tells us things about spirituality. We tend to have beliefs that come from our cultures. Religions are culturally bound to a significant degree. Rituals, when people get married, it doesn't look the same. Or even if people get married, it doesn't look the same. The way we dress, the foods we eat. One of the really significant cultural differences is that some cultures are much more individualistic, and others are much more cooperative and collectivistic. And that's just how it is. There's real differences across our cultures. And today's faculty here at Mesa College, today's staff here at Mesa College, and at City, and at San Diego State, and at UCSD, need to be aware of all of these realities, because we need to be able to teach to people in a way that they can learn and that they feel a part. They see themselves as part of the educational process. However, at a level that is so deep that most of us are not even aware of it, we tend to be dominated by a worldview that permeates how we're taught to think in education and how we're taught to practice and how we help others. This acutely limits our perspective. If we only have one worldview, and it's a worldview that comes from the dominant culture, which is very individualistic, and that's so we press for competition a lot more than we do for cooperation, things like that. So there is a belief system that all of us who are faculty have been trained to believe in, and often we see other ways of looking at reality, other ways of defining what can be known or not known as being weird or different or not valid, because there's just one. So our theories, the methodologies we use, the assumptions that we hold, the way that we problem solve, the way that we understand things, all have cultural components that to a significant degree permeate how we are all trained. So those of us who want to be really culturally competent in our work, how do we learn to be culturally competent if we have been trained to think one way is the correct way? This is how we do research. This is how we engage in scholarship. This is how we teach. This is how people learn. When all of it is permeated by one worldview, it's difficult for those of us who really want to be culturally competent to be able to know how to do that. So we have to educate ourselves. I've I began after I finished my doctorate. I finished my doctorate way back in like 1972, I think. It was the year I got my doctorate. And one of the things that I did was I got a job at Cal State San Bernardino, and I started sitting in on classes by Latino faculty that were talking about what the Mexican-American reality was. And I learned things I didn't know before. I began to go to multicultural conferences, a lot of them, to learn about all the different groups that I didn't know about. How do you know what you don't know? How do you know that there's even anything to know if you haven't been exposed to it? One of the marks of a well-educated person is that they know that they don't know. Mm-hmm. People who are not well-educated think that they may know everything they need. But the more education you get, the more you realize the gaps you've got, the more you realize how much you don't get and how much you need to learn. So this issue of educating ourselves is one that we've had to do. Luckily, we've had now Chicano and Chicana studies programs, African-American or Black studies program, Asian studies programs. We're beginning to really diversify LGBT programs, et cetera. We're beginning to really provide an education for folks that gives us an opportunity to understand many different worldviews and to broaden our own understanding of our world. So that's part of what I think is important to consider when we're thinking about what we're here for today. I want to talk a little bit about the program that I taught in for a long time, because I think it has the way that it was structured and the way that it delivers knowledge and tries to help students gain experience, etc., is unique. I did a sabbatical some years back, and the purpose of my sabbatical was to try to find out if there were any other programs like the community-based block program in existence in the United States or any other Western country. I couldn't find anything. I could not find another program that was like it. So let me describe it to you a little bit. The program started in 1973. That was the year that it first started. And right from the beginning, it attracted very diverse students and faculty. Right from the very beginning, we took into consideration ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, physical ability or disability, and other areas of diversity. And those have always been included in every student cohort. Our cohorts have become more and more and more diverse with time as we've had more refugee students coming from other parts of the world, as more immigrants come. So we've had students from all the continents in our program. Usually more than half of our students are first-generation college students. Usually there's some students that are undocumented in the group. We also have most of our students come from backgrounds of poverty, since most of our students are from underrepresented groups. The faculty are always diverse as well. Right from the beginning, when the program started, Dave Malcolm, who was a white male, hired an African-American colleague and a Latina colleague, right from the beginning. And it's always had at least one African-American, at least one Latino. In fact, one year, your own Dr. Judy Sandayo was a faculty member in CBB. And so we have a really diverse faculty, and we always have had it, so that the students see themselves in us to the greatest degree possible. We have adjunct faculty that work with us as well, and they are also very diverse in every aspect of diversity. The program has tended to not meet on campus right from the beginning. In fact, the reason I'm on the board is because our program didn't meet on campus. Our program for many years met at ECC. Do any of you know where ECC is? The Educational Cultural Complex in Southeast San Diego, Ocean View Boulevard, okay. We've met there, we're still meeting on that campus. Today, there's still once a week, the students there. We used to only meet there. And then later we developed a center where we're actually doing counseling, providing therapy for the community in City Heights on Alcajon Boulevard. So the program's always been in the community for the reason that we wanted our students to feel what it's like to walk around these streets, to be part of a community where this is Crips area or this is not, you know, this is whatever, you know, whatever the groups are, for folks to know this is where you're taking classes. This is the reality of the people. Are there banks around here? Are there grocery stores around here? What's available to folks around here? Are there liquor stores everywhere around here? Things like that. Because communities look very different, don't they? Depending on where you're located. So we've always been in these communities. The program has had learning. We've needed to have objectives and learning goals for our students. And so from the very beginning, we've asked, what are the things that matter most? What do we want our students to come out like? And so these are the four things that we defined as being super important, that we had to be able to conceptualize counseling theories and counseling models and methods from a multicultural feminist perspective and a transformative paradigm, and apply them in both practice and research to integrate multicultural knowledge and experience into counseling theory, practice, and research, to integrate social justice advocacy into counseling theory, practice, and research, and to practice self-awareness and personal insight that supports professional growth and development in the interests of clients and communities. One of the things that we've learned, and that it's important for you to be aware of, if you want to do anti-racism work, if you want to do multiculturally relevant work, one of the things that's absolutely necessary is that you begin by examining one person. Guess who that is? Yourself. Exactly. Every one of us is biased. Every one of us is biased because we've grown up in a world that tells us how to think and how to judge. And we learn to think and judge according to those things. And sometimes when we change from what we were taught, it's a struggle, isn't it? It's a struggle to begin to change and to assert yourself in a new way, or to question things that you used to just know were the truth. And yet that's part of what we have to do. If we're going to work cross-culturally, we've got to get at our biases, we've got to get at our ingrained beliefs, we've got to understand what our own worldview is, and we have to be able to listen with our ears, with our minds, with our hearts, to people who have different experiences, different assumptions, different views of what life is. So that is super important. In this kind of work is self-awareness and insight into ourselves. And it's a year where a lot of people feel like they've learned more than they'd ever learned in their lives about themselves, because they really examine themselves. It's an experiential program. One of the program was developed according to a model that I don't know if any of you have heard of. Carl Rogers was a psychologist who changed psychology to a significant degree. We had Sigmund Freud in his beliefs about people and their instincts, etc. And then following him, the next great move was a move that was cognitive. Cognitive therapies sprang up next that talked about what you believe. If you work on what you believe, you can then change what you do, was the theory behind that. That's simplistically stating it, but that's it. And then the third move was one that Carl Rogers started. And Carl Rogers started another psychologist who was a humanist, who believed that people were basically good. That's a big worldview issue. Does your culture believe that people are basically good? Or does your culture believe that people are basically bad? Do you know? What happens if you believe that people are basically bad? What do you have to do? You have to protect yourself? What else? What else do you do if you think people are basically bad? How do you do education if you think people are basically bad? you dictate top down. You know, they need to learn because they're bad and they need to learn how to be good and how to control all those bad impulses they've got. So it's top down. What else? You got to have a lot of rules, a lot of regulations, a lot of laws telling people what they can and can't do because they're likely to make the wrong choices. And you want them to make the right choices. Think about the culture wars we've been having in this country. You talk about something even like abortion. I'm sure there's a variety of opinions in this room right now about abortion and how easy should it be to get an abortion for a woman. How easy should it be? It depends on how you were raised. It depends on what you believe. And we've had lots of struggles around that. Another one is, are people naturally gay or straight? And by biology, they're born gay or straight. There's people who think everybody is heterosexual. And some people get bad habits or get in with the wrong crowd, and then they begin to be LGBT because they don't believe that it's something that's just inherent part of your natural sexual expression as a human being. By the way, one of the things in our program is we believe that counselors need to be able to talk about anything without embarrassment. We need to ask people if they're talking about their relationships, how their sex lives are. Because that's an important part of a primary relationship that is a partner or marriage or whatever. Obviously not in other relationships, but in your primary relationship. So you have to be able to talk about it without embarrassment, without shame. And that's something I had to learn because I'm a person who was raised very Catholic and didn't say a bad word until I started working with graduate students. And now I use them all the time. My kids, I have to shield my grandkids from me. Sometimes it's the only word I can think of that expresses what I'm feeling at the moment. But I'm sure if I were more eloquent, I could come up with some better not so objectionable words. Anyway, one of the things then is that when we work with folks, we have to experience things. One of the things that Carl Rogers believed, he was the guy that, as I said, formed the program to a large degree, that Dave Malcolm was a good friend of Carl Rogers, who lived here in San Diego. Carl Rogers had his last years in San Diego, and he believed that nothing important can be taught. You can learn things that are just sort of like facts, but things that are really like life-changing, transformative, you can't teach that. You can only learn it by having an experience in which you acquire it. So our program was very experiential, and some of the ways in which it was experiential was that we were in class 20 hours a week, faculty and students together, in groups, working to understand from each other, to learn from each other. And that's different than the classes you take. You go to a class and then you leave and then you go to the next one. We would have all day classes on Mondays and Wednesdays where we would be learning from each other consistently, constantly. And then the other days we were in field placements where we were applying what we were learning. So there was a lot of experience as part of it. We have our students at the clinic in City Heights. If you know anybody who needs psychotherapy, we have a clinic in City Heights on El Cajon and near Fairmont that offers counseling at very low cost, like a dollar to whatever. It's sliding scale, and we'll see families or individuals. And often our students have worked with folks that don't speak English. So our supervisors have to be multilingual. We have to have a good cross-section of supervisors so that they can help students learn how to work with folks in their own language, in their own culture. Most of the clients that we get are poor. Some of them are undocumented. We've had clients, I remember some very vividly, domestic abuse victim who was here undocumented, and she wasn't able to speak up because she was afraid that if she did, she'd get deported. So we have people with those kinds of situations, and And it's coming back, isn't it? It had gotten better. It's coming back now with what's going on. So we work with those kinds of folks in large and small groups in a very experiential way. The program also has five components that are really important, and that is that we make sure we have very diverse communities. I've already talked about that, so that people can learn from each other, because that's one of the things that we do. We give people space to learn from each other, to share their own experiences, and that's how you begin to understand things that you didn't know, by really hearing someone firsthand say what it's like to leave Iraq, what it was like to be a translator for the American, and now you have to leave your country because other people want to kill you. And so then you come here, and then you see what's going on back there, and you feel helpless because you can't go back and you can't help. We had a student a couple of years ago that came from the group of folks that ISIS has targeted, that got captured on the mountains, and that they're on a minority group in Iraq that are not Muslims, that often tend to get targeted by others as infidels because they don't practice the same religion. It's amazing how much religion has impacted who fights with who and about what. It's just an amazing thing. And we have to understand the power of religion and why it has that impact in people and how it impacts people, so that we can work in a way that's kind and accepting and understanding of what people are. So we have very, very diverse communities where they have all kinds of folks that we hear from. The second thing is we try to give people voice, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. We do power sharing and student empowerment. I'll talk about that. Consciousness raising, and then self-awareness and self-examination. So most students in the community-based block program were born and raised in disenfranchised communities where their voices were muted or silenced because they were people of color, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender. They're a female living in a Euro-American male-dominated society. Many have issues with identity, with power, with self-expression because of their experiences. And they often have painful memories of being silenced either in their families or in academia. I mean, I've seen parents silent kids, haven't you? Haven't you seen parents tell kids that they're supposed to just shut up and sit down and we don't want your opinions? The adults are talking, you don't belong here. And there are times when adults need to talk without kids' voices. But I've often heard in very ugly ways, children just told to shut up. Nobody's interested in you. And I think it's important to listen to children personally, because they often have really interesting observations about the rest of us, for one thing. Anyway, so one of the important things then is to give people voice. And you see it happening over the time that people are in the program. At the beginning, some people almost never speak up, and then later on they become more vocal. And one of the important things that we deal with in this process as faculty when we're facilitating this is to make sure we're not dominating all the talking either, because we are so used to talking, right? And also to make sure that we leave space for silence so that people can speak more spontaneously, that we notice who is tending to carry most of the conversation, and that we ask other voices to be heard. So that, you know how that is in every classroom. There'll be three or four people that are always talking, and there'll be like two dozen that never talk or whatever, you know. So we need to make those spaces, because some of this is cultural. Some of this is cultural. Some of it is people with accents. How many of you have ever felt embarrassed because you had an accent when you spoke English? Have any of you ever felt embarrassed about that? I did. A few people here did. Yeah, I remember when I first became a school counselor once, this was in Redlands, California, and there was this little boy that came into my office, and I started talking to him in Spanish. And he said, I don't understand. I speak English. And then when I started talking to him in English, he didn't know what I was saying. But he had already learned that it was something wrong with speaking Spanish, that it was a wrong language to be using, that it, you don't do it. When I was a child, they would actually wash our mouth out with soap if we spoke it. And I went, my first school was a school named Robert E. Lee. Do any of you know who Robert E. Lee is? That was my first public school. And if we spoke Spanish at school, we would get paddled. We'd have our mouths washed out with soap, or we would be kicked out of school because you weren't supposed to, you know, they would tell you, be a good American, learn English, right? But at the same time, when we moved into a neighborhood where there were no Mexicans, there were all white folks living there, our house got stoned and tomatoes thrown, and my brothers got beat up because we didn't belong there. So be a good American, blend in, but not in the wrong place. You know, you get a lot of double messages. People often, yeah, we receive double messages about how we're supposed to be and when. All of us do at different times. So one of the important things then is to make sure that people have an opportunity and have the space to have their voices heard and valued, and that we listen with interest and curiosity. What is it like to be you? I only know what it's like to be me. But if I listen with all my heart and imagine with all my brain, I can begin to imagine what it's like to be a man. I've never tried to be one. I don't know what it would be like to be a man. I have a son, but I still don't know what it's like to be him. I have much more of understanding of what it's like to be a woman because that's what I've lived. And that's true for every dimension, our intersectionality. We all belong to various identity groups, as Dr. Luster stated at the beginning. We all have different identities. So all of those need to be understood, and so that people don't feel socially isolated in groups. The other aspect of the program is power sharing and student empowerment that is really important. Right from the beginning, we try to collapse the hierarchy, and we begin our program by going up to a retreat in Julian, and everybody goes up there, all faculty and students, and then we form a big circle. We always teach in circles so that there's no like obvious hierarchy. And the faculty are intermixed with the students in the group, and then we ask, okay, so what do you want to learn this year, and how do you want to learn it? And the students usually begin with a great deal of dismay, like, how do we know what we need to learn? No, we're new to this, you know. But again, encouraging people to speak up, well, if this is your opportunity to shape a learning environment the way you would really like to have it. How would you like this to be? Who do you want to have teaching you? And what do you want them to teach you? Do you want to teach yourself? Do you want to meet in groups and read books and discuss them yourselves? How do you want to learn? How to become a counselor. Then we also tell them, you're going to be seeing a client in 6 weeks. So you need to know something, because when you see a client in 6 weeks, that person can be a self-mutilator. The person can be trying to come out LGBT. The person can be highly depressed, maybe even suicidal. The person may be coming out of some trauma or tragedy. You don't know. You don't know what clients you're going to get, because we try to screen clients and make sure that they're not too complicated when they see our students, because our students are just beginning, right? And we will come into the room if the situation is too intense for the student. But we watch them through one-way vision windows so that we can see their work and intervene if we need to. If I think somebody's suicidal and the counselor isn't picking it up, I'm going to go in there and do a suicide assessment, right? Because we want to make sure everybody's safe. So they know they have to see people. But we ask them, so what do you want to learn? So then they start, I want to learn about suicide. I want to learn about, you know, so then they begin to come up with lists of things that they want to know to be a counselor. And that list continues to get modified. So the faculty and the students together develop what they're going to learn by having collaborative syllabi, curriculum, even grading processes. And we design shared learning and group experiences. Paulo Freire, have you ever heard of Paulo Freire? He was an educator in Brazil who taught adults how to read by having them examine their lives and ask questions about their lives, so that he would, for example, say, why are you poor and other people rich? And they would start to think about that, and they would start to try to find out. And that's how they began to get interested in learning to read. He was very successful. He brought a lot of literacy to Brazil with his approach. And that approach of power sharing, you know, you decide what you want to learn, and we talk about it. And I'm not necessarily more important than you. In that way, faculty, there's things I know that my students don't know, and there's things they know I don't know. So we can learn from each other. And then we come up with decisions about how we're going to go about it. It's a tedious process and frustrating, but it's an important one because people know that they have a real say in what's going on in their educational experience. And for some people, that's the beginning for them to really feel empowered, because they're equal to faculty. They're the same in terms of their value, in terms of how we see their role. We know, of course, that there's some power differentials, but we look at them honestly, and we talk about them, and we're open to hearing about when we overstep our line. We do consciousness raising in the program. So every year, there's folks that want to know about race and gender bias in research, standardized test bias, domestic violence issues, violence against women issues. I understand there's, on the other side of the campus, they're doing a really good program on domestic violence, and that there's stuff going on right now today here at Mesa College that has to do with that. That's a super, super important topic, because it not only harms the women, of course, that are getting beaten, but it harms the whole family. It's a trauma. If any of you, and I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but if any of you have ever seen one adult, one parent hit the other parent, it can be extremely upsetting. And I hear stories of young people when they were, you know, my students, when they were young, stepping between their parents to keep their father from beating their mother or whatever it was that was going on. So those are, you know, these are important issues. Homelessness. Why do we have so much homelessness? What's that about? Poverty. What are the impacts of poverty? Our social class has profound impact on how we see the world and how we live in the world. War. Do we need to have wars? Why do we need to have wars? What are wars for? Looking at that. How does our country decide on what to invest in, what to spend money on, and what does it say about the values of this country and the values of our culture, if this is the case? And so these are, and many other topics are part of what people are going to want to explore. And so they can bring in guest speakers, they can present. We often have the students who have different expertise levels presenting to the other students what they know. Faculty can present. We can have videos. So there's lots of ways in which people do this. And students work with faculty to focus their research on social justice issues very frequently, so that they're doing research on something that really interests them and matters to them. What do you really wish you understood? And how do you want to go about finding out more about it? So, and sometimes the students will do social activism projects, like going to feed homeless folks, or taking lunches, or taking clothing across the border, or here downtown to places where we have folks who need it. Another area that I mentioned earlier that's super important is self-awareness, and I've already mentioned about that. Right, it's one of the qualities that people who are experts in the field of multicultural counseling say is critical, and that's that you have to have ongoing self-examination. Do you feel like you know yourself better this year than you did last year? Okay, so she says her children help her learn, because you know, she feels like you know, the next generation is kind of pushing you to look at things that you might not be familiar with. Absolutely right. Somebody else back here. One of the most important human experiences is failing, is falling, is not doing it well, and then learning from it, hopefully, or not learning, and then you keep making the same mistake. How many of you know people who keep marrying the same kind of person or having the same kind of boyfriend or girlfriend, constantly the same kind? And almost always that person is like one of their parents, the one they had the most trouble with. Like, I kept choosing men that were emotionally unavailable until now. And the reason was because my major life drama was with my mom. My mom was an abused child who had never received affection and didn't know how to give it. And she was mentally ill and went into a mental hospital and was in and out of mental hospitals all the time I was growing up, from the time I was 14 till 26. So she wasn't able to give me a lot of what I needed in terms of affection. And we all need affection. We all need acknowledgement. We all need to be loved and to feel that someone loves us. So I then began to see if I could find someone who would love me, but I would always choose people that were hard, they were emotionally unavailable. And it isn't a coincidence. People that were emotionally available just seemed not that interesting. It was the challenge I wanted. Well, it also caused a lot of heartbreak and marriages and all kinds. I have a seamy past. I've been divorced twice. So, you know, because I pretty much raised myself. You know, from the time I was 11, we no longer had childcare. So I pretty much raised myself and made mistakes in that process. Because I wanted to win my mother's love by getting a man who was hard to get to love me and to show me and to nurture me and to give me what I didn't have. And we do that in our relationships until we wise up. We'll look for people I did a ride along the other day with the police, because I'm also on the community review board for the police department, because we train the police and I want to know how we're doing it and whether they treat people right or not. And anyway, we were at this one domestic violence scene, and the woman was saying that she had married this guy because he needed help and she wanted to help him. And she said, you know, I should have known better because I've been in this situation a few times. And I'm like, yep, you need, you know, to try to get a little support for yourself so you can understand what that's about. So we need to know what we're about in order to be able to, if we think that men are dogs and a woman says that to us, we're not going to think she's saying anything that needs to be challenged. If she puts everybody into that category, we're just going to think, well, yeah, you're right, yeah. So we need to examine our own biases, our own assumptions, our own craziness. I said to you earlier that you're crazy. We were all born into an imperfect world. Our parents did their best, I believe. Very, very few parents are not doing their best. Most of them really genuinely want to do right by their children. But they have their own demons or their own issues that they haven't worked out, their own craziness. So we are born into a world that's crazy. We're pretty perfect when we come, most of the time anyway, unless there's been some trauma. But then we start picking up, oh, girls do this, boys do that, you don't do this, blah, 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 this is right, this is wrong. We start getting our biases from the world around us. We start seeing how, you know, our beliefs start getting shaped. And some of our beliefs are distorted. We don't see the world as it is. We see it as we are. And so that's what we have to examine. If you're working in mental health, you absolutely have to take that journey yourself so that you begin to understand what it is that biases you so that you can put it aside. And you can, there can only be, one of the things that we've told our students is there can only be one crazy person in that room at one time. You have to keep your craziness out of the room. That sounds easy. It's not. One of my crazinesses, for example, is I want to save everybody. I want to rescue people. I tend to overdo that part where I'm like trying to help so much that I'm disempowering them rather than supporting their own adulthood, their own growth, their own knowing that, yeah, they're going to fall, but they can pick themselves up and I'll be there to help them do it when they need to be picked up to the best of my ability. But I tend to want to rescue them because I didn't have anybody to rescue me when I had a teacher that wouldn't call me by my first name, or when I had other kids that wouldn't play with me because we were the only Mexicans in the school, or whatever things happened to us. No one rescued me. I never talked about those things. My family didn't even know. One of the awful things that happens if you are the subject of racism, or and even more happens if you're the subject of sexual abuse, is you develop shame. You believe that there's something wrong with you. Why did they pick me to molest? There must have been something about me. And that's never the case. There's people in this room who have been sexually abused. It's never your fault if you're a child and an adult is doing this to you. It's, or an older child that's several years older than you. It's never your fault. But we develop a sense of shame and we don't want people to know about it. The same thing happens with racism frequently. We don't want other people to know because it's embarrassing that other people think we're inferior. And so we don't want to talk about that. That's hard. That's hard to take in and to live with. So these are the things that we need to explore. These are the things that we need to be able to talk about. How have all these things impacted our lives? So these are some of the kinds of things that we do in our classes. One of the things that we do is we ask our students when they want to learn a particular technique. Like, well, I have a favorite therapeutic technique, which is called chairs. It's from a Gestalt therapist, and it's a process in which I put two chairs, and the student or the client moves between the two chairs. Either it can be, I do want to go to Canada, or I don't want to move to Canada, so that you can talk to the different sides of yourself as you're trying to figure out something, or you can finish unfinished business with people in your life. I can talk to my mother if I wanted to. Put my mother in the chair and say, Mom, why didn't you ever hug me? Why didn't you ever kiss me? And then I can get into her chair and answer from my knowledge, from the best I could do to be in her role. And it's amazing how much we often know about the other side. We ask questions, but often we know a lot about the other side. Anyway, that's one of my favorite techniques. But when we do it, when I model any technique on how to do any kind of therapy, I always ask people to bring in a real problem, not a made-up one. Something that's real to you. It doesn't have to be a big one. It can be a little one. But something that's real to you that you're willing to talk about right now. And so people work on themselves. They work on their own real issues. Also, all of our students have to be in therapy in order to work with clients. They've got to walk that journey before they can see clients, and then they have to keep going to therapy the whole time they're in training, because there's always more to learn. I'm as old as I am now, as I said earlier, I'm 73 3/4, and I've turned into the little kid. Remember how the little kids would say, I'm 5 1/2, I'm almost 6, well, that's me now. And in this time, I still don't know everything I could know. I still every now and then discover some element of myself that I'm still struggling with that I thought, I'm not self-actualized yet. I don't know if I ever will be. I doubt it. I think we are a work in progress until the work stops. So these are some of the kinds of things that we examine with our students, and we have our students examine. Always we have self-examination, self-growth. And then we have to deal with, as a program, how do we assess this? We've got an outcomes-based society that says that everything has to be measured. How do we measure what we're trying to teach. How do we even begin that part? So we've come into lots of conversations about, so how do we do this? And we wound up developing 4 written comprehensive exams that students are required to pass. One is on a counseling theory or model. They have to have their own idea of what it is that they're going to be doing with people. You need to know what you're going to be doing with people, because if you just start practicing what you see but you don't understand why it goes together, you're not going to do a very good job, because people are unpredictable and they'll come up with things you didn't know they were going to come up with. You can't have a formula. So you've got to have some idea of what you do. The second one is a multicultural healing. And that's an examination that looks at a non-Western way of doing emotional healing. Everybody doesn't go to therapy. Obviously, most of you haven't been in therapy. How do people heal their wounds? How do people get past their traumas? What do they do in the Hmong society? What do they do in Oaxaca? What do they do in Iraq? How do people heal? So everyone explores a non-Western way of healing. That's another exam. The third exam is the self of the counselor, where people do a deep exploration and sharing of their growth as they've been in the program. So what have you learned and where are you now? And there's questions that go with it. So there's a self of the counselor, your own personal growth one. A research exam, where you are expected to conduct a research project that has a social justice component. And then the final exam is an oral exam. It's a law and ethics exam, where they've got to understand the law of our field and the ethics of our field. One of the very, very important things is that we need to be ethical in everything that we do. So those are the exams we have. And so with the way that we do it is the students will submit their exams, but they're allowed to retake them. It's not like, okay, you're done, you failed, you're done. We provide support for the student to learn and to grow and to do a better job. And so we will turn it back to give them a chance to rewrite aspects that they need to rewrite. So we give them multiple tries if they need them, in order to succeed. But we want them to come up with something that's theirs and that demonstrates that they know whichever exam it is. So because we know that a lot of our students have been miseducated, or a lot of our students have been taught that they are not intelligent enough to learn. A lot of people haven't bothered to really invest in helping them write well, for example. Writing is a big issue for a lot of our students. And it's becoming a bigger and bigger issue because now dominant society students don't write either. They text. And so we have a world in which people don't necessarily know how to construct sentences. And in our field, we need to be able to, if we're going to be professionals, we need to be able to write. And so one of the things I tell my students is, I'm really, really sorry this is so hard, but you really need to know it. Because I have been at a university where I have seen a staff member send a memo to the president that had misspellings, and I've seen people laugh at them. I've seen people laugh at the other people on the staff because they have misspellings. Be careful of that. Really, this is a very sincere comment I'm making to you. When you become a professional, please, if you know that you have trouble with writing, have somebody help you with editing, because when you send stuff in that has grammatical errors and spelling errors, people will judge your intelligence. It doesn't have to do with intelligence. It has to do with a skill that you don't have and that you can learn. But that's hard. The older you get, the harder it is, for most of us anyway. So we, you know, we give people chances to retake them, to learn, because they need to be able to experience success. We do indirect assessment measures as well, besides, you know, directly assessing the students and the faculty assessing them in practicum, where they can see their work and see whether they're able to work with people in a good way. But we also have department exit surveys. We have alumni outcome surveys, academic reviews conducted every 6 years. qualitative studies involving students, alumni, and employers. So we have a lot of different things that are part of the assessment process, because we have to be able to assess. Why I was sharing this is because I think this translates to other educational experiences. I think all faculty, not just when you're training counselors, can share some of these same strategies, all faculty. Like some of the things that we do with our students is we have things like cultural plunges, where you put yourself in a situation you've never been in before. A person who grew up in a very sort of protected family that has had no culture, no contact with LGBT issues, they go to a gay bar and see what that's like. A person who's never been in a community where most of the folks are African American goes to a black church. Take cultural plunges, and the purpose of the plunges is not to go look at those other people and see what are they like. It's to look at yourself. What's happening to me as I'm here? What am I noticing? What am I thinking? What's coming up for me emotionally, intellectually, as I'm in this environment that's not mine? So cultural plunges is something other people can do. As you know, in the program I teach in, the students have a voice, and they can say what they want to learn, and they can ask for what they want. But I think that can happen in other classrooms as well, is to talk with the faculty and say, you know, I'm wondering if we can explore this, that, or the other that's not present so far here, but that's relevant to the class. It needs to be relevant to the class, obviously. But I think that people need to speak up and say what they need to do. They can also do papers on things that they're interested in. They can also do research projects on things that they're interested in. So that there's different ways that we can get experiences in learning what isn't present there. Because we need to know more things other than what we learn from a Eurocentric perspective, because there's a lot more, especially as the world is changing. I have a lot more that I could be saying, but I think I'm going to skip to... Oh, we also do these oppression statements that I think are interesting, where it started because I was invited to speak at an All People's Breakfast, Martin Luther King Day. And they chose like 7 different people to speak for our culture for 2 minutes. So I was supposed to talk for 2 minutes about what it was like to be Mexican. Somebody else spoke for 2 minutes on what it was like to be disabled. Somebody spoke for 2 minutes about what it was like to be African American, etc. And I got a lot from the experience. And so we started having our students do it. And then when people asked me to speak, I wouldn't go. I'd go with my students, and they would all share their statements, their oppression statements about how their group was oppressed. If any of you are interested, I can give you more detail on that later. Oppression and resiliency. How have I survived? What is my resiliency? Anyway, those are some of the kinds of things. But let me begin my conclusion, because... doing this kind of work where we are trying to help people understand themselves, we're trying to help people learn how to be more effective in changing other people and changing the world, means that we have to do a lot of work on ourselves, as I said before, that we have to learn a lot. We have to understand why and when we do what we do and we don't. But the ultimate product should be that the human that we've been working with comes out of the experience of working with us more able to be fully human and functional, more able to be tender, more able to be courageous, more able to laugh, to love, to struggle, to experience their pain and not deny it, and the pain and suffering of others without looking away. We often look away from other people's pain and suffering because we haven't faced our own. Because we haven't faced our own, and it brings up our own stuff. So we don't want to think about it, or we don't want to see the other's pain. So we have to, that's the kind of work that we're doing. And one of the things that has created more pain in our society to the folks that I am committed to working with is discrimination. All the discrimination that we face. Racism is a birth defect of the United States. People came here and attacked the native people that were here. and took their land and slaughtered them and slaughtered their way of living. We brought people on slave ships that didn't choose to come. Millions and millions and millions of who died before they even made it here. And then somehow people lived through that and survived. And we have lovely people that have a background from Africa. Their journey has not been easy. Being a woman in a male world that's dominated by male power has not been easy, etc. And politicians consistently run against immigrants and against crime, and both have racist components, right? Who are the most people that get thrown into prisons and jails? There's a racial component to it. Most drug users are white, but most drug arrests are of blacks and Latinos. I don't know if you're familiar with the traffic study that they just did with traffic stops in San Diego, where they said there's not really any big difference in the numbers of people, I mean, or in the, yeah, the numbers of people that are stopped, but blacks and Latinos are searched more than whites. And when people are searched, there's more contraband on whites than there are on blacks and Latinos, but yet they're not the ones that are searched most. What's that about? Oh, we all have unconscious biases. We all have unconscious biases. So all of these things then create a sense then of being victimized. Diversity programs often exist because people think diversity is a problem. That's not true at Mesa College. But in a lot of places, people say, well, we better do some diversity programs because people are attacking each other. It's not necessarily in order to create a world that's more just or a company that's more fair in how they treat people. But it's a result of fear. People are afraid of racial tensions and racial incidents. What's happening right now in this country is we're seeing a contest of who's going to have power and influence. And people in power see their institutions as belonging to them. And frequently, if there are not many people of color in it, they're seen as not belonging there. But people of color will respond with, hey, we need to have our place as well, and we need to share. But the result is that people on both sides often are afraid or unsure. There's a growing gap now between rich and poor. You've heard Bernie Sanders talk about it. By the way, that was my guy for the election. But you've seen him talk about it, about this huge divide, and it's just growing. The earnings of the poorest half are much, you know, they're so much less than they ought to be, and wages have grown for people at a much slower rate than for the CEOs. So some of the things that happen because of racism is that because the electorate is often older and whiter, they defeat school bonds, they defeat taxes that could be helpful to people. And then what happens? Racism costs money. In welfare, in unemployment, in crime, in police, in prisons, in loss of energy, in loss of motivation, in brain power. I have met some amazingly brilliant people who struggled to speak in English, but they were brilliant. And we need their knowledge. We need what, maybe the cure for cancer is sitting in here right now. We don't know. We need to empower everybody so they can bring to the table their own talents. We have to unlearn racism. And guilt doesn't help. We're all biased. Dave Malcolm used to say that he was a recovering sexist and a recovering racist and a recovering homophobe. And so am I. And anyone who's doing this work ought to recognize that. We're never perfect. We never get there so that we're totally unbiased and totally. So we need to do what we can to eliminate these things. Bigotry is worldwide. It's human, but we can unlearn it. We need to look at the structures of power because that's where it matters most. It isn't an individual's opinion. An individual can have a racist opinion, but if they have no power, they can't do much with it. But if they have power, then it matters. That's why I'm on the police review board, because they've got power. They've got guns and badges. And so their biases can act out in ways that might be dangerous to others. And so we need to know that they're getting trained so that they're unlearning racism and their own, and they're understanding their own biases. So we need to examine the structures of power in order to challenge them. Diversity also gives us an opportunity to learn ourselves, because as I help you examine yourself, you help me examine myself. I see myself. Tú eres mi otro yo. You are my other me, is one of the sayings that Indigenous people have. We can together create a different social order so that we can become out of all of these, they and over there and they over there, we can become us. And that's what matters. When you realize that you care about a group that's very different from you and that you care about justice for them as much as you care about your own, it can be wonderful. I was so moved to see people go to the airport to protest the ban on immigrants coming from Muslim countries. I was so moved that people just did it spontaneously. Nobody organized it. They just did it. And I think that we're at an age now where people are beginning to really activate ourselves, and it's very exciting to see it. You really matter. My generation dropped the ball. When we're gone, the world will be better off. Young people are more open. They're more fluid in their self-understanding. They're braver at looking at differences. They embrace it without thinking very much about it. It's just not that big a deal. We need the idealism that you have in order to improve our world. So you can make it better. We together can make it better until we're done. One of my favorite songs that I want played at my memorial comes from the play Men of La Mancha, which is about Don Quixote. And one of the lines in it says, "To fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause." Those sentiments of being, you know, brave and strong, I have to kind of remind myself, because I'm not that brave, but I try. And there are causes, many causes right now that we need you. One of them is that we need to create one nation with liberty and justice for all. That's a cause that's worth living for. Thank you.